Some of this material overlaps a bit with Professor Higgs' lecture that some of you just heard on the FDA and quality assurance and that kind of thing. So I apologize in advance for any overlap, but I've learned from teaching for some years that students usually benefit from hearing things twice. So if there is some overlap, I hope you'll excuse me. I'm shocked when I get my senior undergraduate students and I have to remind them of the concept of opportunity cost and that kind of thing. So it's very distressing and demoralizing to a professor to realize that something you taught 3 years ago has a half-life of about 3 weeks at most. And anyway, what I'd like to talk with you about today is health economics. I had an interest in health economics from pretty much the very beginning of my study of economics as an undergraduate. And this is because my father was a physician, and he was active in a group called the Association of American Physicians and Surgeons, or AAPS, which is a great free market physicians organization. And they've been around for a long time doing some really good work. Counter to the far more statist AMA. So if you're interested in some resources by physicians for physicians on issues such as those I'm talking about today, the AAPS website is great, and I've got some material in here in which I quote from them. I'd like to do this in two parts. The first is on pharmaceuticals and profits and regulation. I would like to just mention as a kind of a preface here, Bob Higgs' book that he edited called Hazardous to Our Health, FDA Regulation of Healthcare Products. Excellent resource on this material. And I'm sure that there's a lot that I would say that I would agree with from that book. Drug companies in the United States and elsewhere enjoy government-granted privileges. They have patent protection. They have the FDA protection against competitors. There are barriers to entry. We'll talk about some of those. Hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars that it costs to bring a new drug to market. And who does this benefit but those who already have a drug treating the same kind of illness that's already in the market? Then there are these ordinary corporate protections. We've unfortunately gotten used to some of these things. And that tends to keep competitors out of the market as well and also limit the degree to which pharmaceutical companies can be disciplined by the market for failure to do what consumers want. So if you listen to the lecture by Ronald Hamowy earlier this week, I think that was on Tuesday, the audio of that is already online. He did some great work on the Canadian Medicare-type system that they have, and I'll refer to that again later. But Canada and some other countries have a kind of a monopsony system in which the government is the only buyer, effectively, of drugs. So what are the effects of this? Miller, Benjamin, and North, in a book called The Economics of Public Issues, a neat little book with a number of short treatments of various economic issues, they say that a single government agency in each country acts as a monopsony buyer of healthcare services on behalf of everyone. Individuals are either prevented from buying healthcare on their own or limited by government rules as to what they may buy. Like other monopsonies, the national health insurance systems force down the prices of the goods they buy, such as drugs, medical devices, and physicians and nurses' services. This, in turn, reduces the quantities of those goods and services that suppliers will provide, particularly in the long run. The bad news, at least if you are a consumer of healthcare services, is that less healthcare is provided. Let's talk a little bit about advertising. Advertising for an approved drug for a newly discovered use violates FDA rules. I'm not even talking about advertising a new drug, which already has its own hurdles to jump over, but we're talking about a drug that's already been on the market for some other purpose, And the purveyors of this drug think, well, maybe there's something else that this drug can do that we hadn't initially gotten FDA approval for. Well, you're violating FDA rules if you take this old drug and you advertise a new use for it without getting the FDA approval. And some companies are simply not going to find it economically advantageous to revisit that approval process for each new use. And if you don't think that drugs have multiple uses, you're mistaken. Take a look at aspirin, which I will use later as an example of this. The new use, whatever that is, might be relatively unknown if it's not advertised. Advertising is a provision of information to consumers about the possible uses of a product. New drugs, according to Tom DiLorenzo, do consumers no good if they do not know about them. Advertising restrictions imposed by the FDA, therefore, prop up the profits of incumbent drug marketers at the expense of newcomers in the industry and at the expense of consumers. So the FDA is essentially working on behalf of the existing pharmaceutical companies in a way that prevents innovation, prevents things that will come along, that could come along, that would benefit consumers. And the United States has a relatively free situation in this regard. Other countries are even more restrictive. Canada would be a good example of this. What about aspirin? Well, I mentioned this earlier, but in 1988, at a meeting in the offices of the FDA commissioner, companies making aspirin were told that they could not advertise the benefits of aspirin in reducing the risk of a first heart attack. If they did, they were told explicitly that the FDA would bring legal action. So as a consequence, there was a long-term ban on advertising aspirin for prevention of heart attacks, which, because of the absence of that information on the part of consumers, led to tens of thousands of needless deaths per year. This is from Thomas Sowell in his book Applied Economics, quoting Paul Rubin, and you can take a look at the presentation when it's posted later and look up some of these references. The FDA is well known for testing drugs and testing foods and making sure, supposedly, that they are safe for consumers, but they can make two types of errors when they do this testing. They can first reject a drug that has benefits greater than the costs. That's called a type 1 error. Or they can accept a drug that has costs greater than the benefits. That's a type 2 error. And what's happened with the FDA is that they have put an inordinate amount of attention on trying to reduce those type 2 errors. The matrix here shows the two possibilities, the state of the world, either the benefits of the new drug exceed the costs or the costs exceed the benefits. The FDA can then accept or reject the drug. There's no negative effect if the benefits exceed the costs and the FDA passed the drug. I will add a little caveat there that getting the drug accepted by the FDA did probably cost some hundreds of millions of dollars, in some cases possibly more, and that itself has a detrimental effect, as we'll see. But if they end up accepting a drug that doesn't have a negative effect, then you can say, well, apart from the cost of getting the regulation, jumping the hurdles of the regulation, at least we wound up with the drug on the market. There's also no negative effect if a drug which had costs greater than benefits is kept off the market. Now, how do we know if the costs exceed the benefits? I would argue that the market is exceedingly good at trying to sort out which drugs have costs that exceed benefits and which ones have benefits that exceed costs. I would not say that just because you discover that a drug has some negative side effects, that this means that the drug should not be on the market. Typically, people don't like to put things into their bodies that do them some net harm. And I'll point out in my talk later today on consumer product safety, there's an article in the fall 2010 issue of the Independent Review on food safety regulation that makes a good point about how good the market is at sorting these kinds of things out. But there are two types of errors, as I said, one where the FDA accepts a drug where the costs exceed the benefits, and one where they reject a drug where the benefits exceed the cost. And this is just from the conventional understanding of what the FDA is supposed to be doing, according to the mainstream view of regulation. But they cannot even meet the standard of their own, of the mainstream view of what regulation ought to be doing. The consensus in the economics literature, and this is just mainstream economics literature, suggests that the FDA has placed too great of an emphasis on type 2 errors. So they're trying to avoid the problem of admitting a drug to the market that later indicates some kind of major side effect. The FDA will tote out their ban of thalidomide as an example of the kind of thing that the FDA is supposed to be doing, and look how great we are, we banned thalidomide and Europeans allowed it and we prevented all these birth defects. Now, most of you are too young to remember what thalidomide was or to have read about it even, and it's a drug that was given for morning sickness in pregnant women, and it turned out to cause birth defects, severe birth defects. And the FDA says, well, see, this is why we're here. We're here to keep people from consuming things that are bad for them. Well, to use the term from Bastiat, that's what's seen. What is unseen are the type 1 errors where they fail to approve or delay the approval of a beneficial new drug. So in the process of trying to do all of this testing and evaluation and clinical trials and so forth to try to keep a drug off the market that has side effects that are too severe in the judgment of the FDA, they are delaying, inevitably, drugs that would have a positive effect. One political factor, according to Viscusi, Harrington, and Vernon, is that the victims of those type 2 errors are more readily identifiable. You can say, well, here are the pictures of the victims who had the birth defects because of the drug that caused them. All right. So the people who die or suffer because of a drug not being admitted to the market are much more difficult to identify. Now, when AIDS came onto the scene, and AIDS victims said, well, we have, for what we know about AIDS, we have a death sentence on our heads. This is a fatal disease. You might as well let us try a drug to combat AIDS. And while you're sitting there testing this over 8 or 10 years, many of us are going to die. Why not let us at least give it a shot? And so this led to an improvement, at least, in the speed with which the FDA would approve certain drugs, a kind of a fast track. But it by no means permeated the FDA's policy on these things, and the FDA still produces enormous delays. The FDA is under this kind of inevitable political pressure as a bureaucracy. If the FDA approves a drug that's later found to be unsafe in any way, the news media, the public, politicians will all say, well, the FDA behaved badly, they committed an error. But if the agency delays when reviewing applications, the patients who need these new treatments are worse off and may even die waiting for the FDA to act. But the FDA is only criticized for approving a so-called bad medicine rather than keeping a beneficial one off the market. So they have this kind of culture at the FDA of requiring longer trials, stricter monitoring after they market the drug initially, and then they're more ready to pull a drug off the market at the first sign of any kind of negative side effect, which leads to fewer options on the part of patients, rising drug prices, unnecessary suffering, and unnecessary death. How did it come to be this way? Well, the FDA didn't always have the power that it now does. In 1906, the FDA's rule was basically that they were not going to approve medicines that had a substance harmful to your health. So if you tried to market something that had arsenic in it, they would probably say, well, don't think that should be on the market. 1938, they said, well, manufacturers are required to demonstrate safety. Now, if you've had your basic economics courses, you understand that economists will not see safety as an either-or concept. It's not either the drug is safe or it's unsafe. It's a sliding scale, okay? There's no perfectly safe drug. You can kill yourself by drinking water if you wanted to. I mean, drugs all have some kind of side effect consumed in enough quantities. So it's a trade-off, really. How safe do you want the drug to be? It's not as though the FDA is able to discover that some drug is unsafe or some other drug is safe. There's a sliding scale. What's the appropriate trade-off? There's no way for the FDA to know that. But in 1938, manufacturers were required to demonstrate safety. 1962 came the change in regulation that really added to the length of time that it took for the FDA to approve a drug, because the FDA then began to say, we're only going to approve a drug if it's safe and effective. Well, how effective is another question, kind of like how safe. But now you can't just approve a drug that's harmless and ineffective. You have to show that it does the thing for which it is intended, to the FDA's satisfaction. Prior to the 1962, the FDA was required to approve within 180 days unless the drug was not proven safe. After 1962, no time limit. So as a result of this, the drug approval process was lengthened. Prior to 1962, the time from filing for a new drug to approval by the FDA averaged about 7 months. By 1967, 5 years after the regulatory change, it was 30 months. By the late 1970s, it was 8 to 10 years. And along with this extension in the approval process came an increase in the costs. The hurdles are increasing in height. It's becoming more difficult for the pharmaceutical company to satisfy the FDA, and the approval cost jumped into the hundreds of millions of dollars. About said hundreds of billions. I guess I'm thinking about national debt or something. Septra, for example. This is an antibiotic. There was a 5-year delay in introducing this to the U.S. market. One estimate by George Hitchings indicates that this delay cost 80,000 lives in the United States. My PowerPoint here says he was a Nobel laureate, although we understand that that has lost some of its meaning lately. Once they gave the Nobel Prize to Paul Krugman, I figured it's not exactly a feather in your cap anymore. But beta blockers, lag in the FDA approval there may have cost 250,000 lives in the United States. So this is the unseen part of the seen and the unseen. You see the pictures of the thalidomide victims. You don't see the victims of the heart attacks caused or the people who died of infection because the FDA delayed approval of a beneficial new product. Rotavirus. Almost all children contract rotavirus by the age of 5, which produces about 55,000 hospitalizations and 20 to 40 deaths a year. In September 1998, the FDA approved RotaShield, which was a vaccine for rotavirus. The CDC then recommended that this be used for all infants within a year of the FDA's approval. All right, so now we're combining two regulatory agencies. We've got the FDA saying, this is fine, and then you've got the CDC putting pressure on the adoption of this new drug. Well, over 1 million children were immunized. There were 2 deaths and 99 cases of bowel obstruction that resulted from, that were reported to have resulted from this vaccine. But we think we know, that the system for reporting these adverse effects catches maybe 10% of the actual vaccine-caused injuries. So multiplying the 2 deaths by 10, and we get about 20, possibly, that were actually caused, and then a number of other injuries or hospitalizations from the vaccine alone. So it's not real clear on balance whether the vaccine actually helped. Now, I'm not anti all vaccines, but once you combine the FDA saying these things are safe and effective, and then the CDC putting intense pressure on the adoption of these things, the whole government school system saying, you have to have X number of vaccinations before your child can enter the school, and we're going to require a child to go to school. And this further encourages the use of these things that the FDA has said are appropriate. One member of the CDC committee who recommended that the rotavirus vaccine be added to the Vaccines for Children program holds a patent on the rotavirus vaccine. Was paid by a large pharmaceutical company to develop the vaccine, and did not recuse himself from voting on issues surrounding the vaccine. Can you say conflict of interest? All right. It's always surprising to me, well, not surprising anymore, I guess, but it's distressing when people say, well, you know, private industry is, there's all these conflicts of interest and principal-agent problems and so forth, but the government, you know, will fix all of that. Several members of the FDA and CDC committees owned stock in the drug companies and stood to gain from government immunization requirements. Vioxx. Now, the FDA is, on the one hand, it's delaying approval of beneficial drugs, and then on the other hand, it's got drugs that it approved, and then information that may come out later about the risks of the drug, it sits on this information. It doesn't disperse it as we expect the FDA, or we would like to expect the FDA to do. So there was a Lancet study revealing Vioxx problems. This was delayed, information was essentially suppressed. David Graham, who was a 20-year FDA employee, said, "What I believe they were trying to prevent from reaching the public was our estimates of the number of people who suffered heart attacks or died because of Vioxx use." He said, "I believe there were multiple levels of FDA management who wanted to keep the information of the magnitude of harm caused by Vioxx from the public and wanted to damage my credibility as a scientist." The whistleblower gets suppressed because he's trying to say that the FDA has approved a drug that ends up later with indications of being hazardous, and that information is... the FDA sits on this information. He said, I would assume the reason this happened is because the FDA sees its mission primarily as one of serving the pharmaceutical industry. With Vioxx, the FDA looked the other way, and America paid a severe price for it. If you want more on this, this came largely from an article by Dale Steinrich that's posted on Mises.org. Steinrich goes on to say that it turns out the 10 members of the FDA panel who voted for both Vioxx and Bextra not only had ties to their makers, but their votes were crucial for securing the favorable votes on the panel for both drugs. Again, conflict of interest, it appears. $800 million for a new drug to be approved by the FDA. This is sort of the broken window problem again. You could have, really, an opportunity cost problem. You could have used that $800 million somewhere else. By increasing the hurdle, you're delaying the introduction of a new beneficial, possibly beneficial drug. You're also costing lives simply because $800 million can do a lot of good things to improve human health and well-being. Some studies indicate that for about every $10 to $17 million of a drop in income, one life is lost on average. We don't know exactly who this is or where this is or how this is, but when people's incomes fall, we do know that their life expectancies are shortened. Wealthier countries tend to have longer life expectancies. So if regulation is imposing these rather significant costs on the economy, we know that life expectancies are going to be shortened. We can count not particular people, but we can say that lives are going to be lost. Take $800 million divided by $17 million, and we get 47 lives lost, approximately, just from the financial cost of drug approval. This is not counting the delay. The delay, as we've seen for beta blockers, might have been quarter million lives lost. Another problem that the FDA presents is that individual patients have different situations, different physiologies, different conditions. Even their family situation makes a powerful difference in the effectiveness of a drug. Conko and Arnett in 2008 said that every day thousands of physicians and patients make myriad choices from available drug options. They take into account differences in effectiveness, side effects, and drug interactions for each individual patient. FDA scientists, they say, may know a lot about the drugs they evaluate and their average effects on thousands of users, but they know nothing about the individualized physiology of each patient. On the other hand, intensively trained, and I would say experience counts for a lot, not just training, but experienced clinical physicians who do have knowledge of individual patients are best able to advise them if a drug is appropriate. One of the problems we'll talk about a little bit later, if I've got some time, is that an individual doctor who has a relationship with an individual patient, the patient sitting there in the office, they have a conversation, they talk about some things, the doctor may realize this patient is incapable of managing too many drugs at one time. Or the patient may have budget constraints that cause them to limit the prescriptions they will actually fill. Or the patient may have peculiar side effects that are unusual for this particular drug. There may be a host of individual constraints on this particular patient. So an FDA scientist who may say, well, this drug is appropriate and safe and effective and so forth, it may not be for that particular patient. Or vice versa. All right, what have we learned so far? Monopsony buyers, government buyers of drugs can discourage long-run pharmaceutical innovation and maybe other therapies. We know that advertising does produce some useful information about drugs, including new uses that were unknown when the drug was first approved. AZT, I'm told, which is an AIDS drug, was originally an anti-cancer drug. The FDA may avoid deaths from less safe new drugs, but at the cost of suppressing or delaying beneficial new ones. The FDA, we know also by either corruption or incompetence, may allow drugs onto the market that have costs in excess of benefits. RotaShield, Vioxx, we mentioned those. And then the FDA may assume that the research of its investigators supersedes the knowledge of the patient and special circumstances in clinical medicine. Let me go back to this one for a second because I want to make sure you understand. I'm not saying that the FDA should ban a drug or prevent a drug from getting onto the market that may have some negative side effects. If I could push a button right here and eliminate the FDA permanently, I would push it without hesitation. I see it as an imposition on human liberty to have a government agency standing in the way of me and a provider that I believe produces a product that will make me better off. Okay? So I'm not saying that the FDA should approve or should not approve a drug that I would like to consume that I think is going to make me better off, even if I'm in fact wrong about that. Okay. However, when I have conversations with my students and others about this kind of regulation, many people are under the impression that if a drug is approved by the FDA, then it's certifiably safe and I'm happy with it, and the FDA is protecting me against the ravages of greedy drug companies, and that's the thing keeping me safe, is that regulation. So the impression that the FDA provides of guarding the public against bad drugs is itself harmful. People may not do as much investigation. Doctors may not do as much investigation. Insurance companies may not do as much investigation into the kinds of drugs that they are willing to approve because they take the FDA's approval as a stamp of safety and effectiveness, when it in fact may not be, as the Vioxx case shows. All right, let's look secondly at bureaucracy and medical costs. I take the core of this from Mises' book, Bureaucracy, which appeared in 1944. Mises says that in this book, which I would recommend, it's very accessible, it's quite good. He says, the government by its nature is formalistic and rigid. You know this by your interactions with the government. You know this from stories you've read of the abuses of the TSA. You fly through an American airport. The TSA agent does not care if you're 87 years old and incontinent and you don't have the mental ability to understand what's going on, as we saw a case just like this not too long ago. Woman was traveling through an airport with her daughter or granddaughter and subjected to all kinds of intrusive safety inspections by the TSA. And the TSA agent does not care about the individual circumstances because the TSA agent knows the TSA agent will never be held personally liable for following the rules. Okay. Any deviation from the rules is a liability for that particular bureaucrat. You know this if you've been stopped by a police officer for speeding. It doesn't matter what your reasons are. It doesn't matter if the costs and benefits of your actions are such that the benefits are 10 times greater than the cost. You can explain that until you're blue in the face to the police officer. I remember a conversation I had with Ben Powell. He came to visit Wofford College some years ago, and he said, well, I was driving in L.A. and was in the HOV lane, that left-hand lane they reserve for multiple passenger vehicles and so forth. And he said it was pretty much empty, and the other lanes were pretty full. So he, by himself, got into that lane, speeding along. He was pulled over by a police officer. And he told me that the police officer came up and he said, you realize, of course, that all these people over here in this other lane, these other lanes are mad at you for what you're doing. And Ben says, well, they really shouldn't be because, by leaving their lanes and coming over into this lane, I'm allowing them to go a little faster. So, and the police officer says, well, I don't think it works that way. And Ben says, well, that's why you're a cop. That's what he told me. I'm sure he got a ticket if that's what he said. So, but cops are bureaucrats, basically. They don't care what the reasons were if you're speeding, generally. If you were speeding, then you get a ticket. Cost and benefit analysis, completely out of the question as far as, your costs and your benefits. What they're thinking about is, my sergeant will be upset with me if I did not give X number of tickets per month or whatever the system is that they have for measuring the performance of police officers. So the core problem for bureaucracy, according to Mises, is a lack of a measure of success and failure. Bureaucrats are not operating according to profit and loss, unlike an entrepreneurially driven private enterprise. So Mises says it's vain to lament over the fact that the assiduity, carefulness, and painstaking work of the average bureau clerk are, as a rule, below those of the average worker in private business. There is no, as he says, there is no unquestionable yardstick of success and failure. Hayek, in his well-known article from 1945, The Use of Knowledge in Society, if you haven't read that, I recommend it. He said, "The sort of knowledge with which I've been concerned is knowledge of the kind which by its nature cannot enter into statistics and therefore cannot be conveyed to any central authority in statistical form." Now, I'm not going to get into the kind of dehomogenization debate between Mises and Hayek over the nature of knowledge and the nature of the socialist calculation problem and that kind of thing. But and that is not a worthwhile debate and that you shouldn't read it. But what Hayek is saying here is that some information cannot be, by its very nature, transmitted in a timely manner to central authorities. So for that reason, Hayek is saying it is impossible for a central planner to make good decisions. Now, I would ask in connection to the medical care issue, can a doctor-patient encounter be evaluated by a central authority who does not have that individual knowledge of the circumstances of time and place? That goes for an insurance company or a government. Can a government agent 1,000 miles away from that encounter between the patient and the doctor in the examining room, can that central authority say, well, the doctor did the wrong thing? There's too much information there. And what I'm very concerned about this trend in medicine toward condensing the results of an examination into a few items on a form. There are things that are relevant that are not on the form. There are things that are on the form that aren't relevant. Newt Gingrich has been at the heart of some of this to try to promote this digitization of medical exams, and we've seen this appearing in regulation. So if you try to scale medical care upward with that doctor-patient encounter being scrutinized by central planners some thousands of miles away, does carry risks. Coding, medical coding, current procedural terminology or CPT coding, it misses information that's important. Doctors may be forced to choose, do I satisfy the regulator or do I meet the patient's needs? And conscientious doctors who care about the patient may end up doing what is good for the patient but very bad for in terms of what the regulator wants. So they end up bending the rules, breaking the rules, and so the regulatory authorities see this and say, well, they're not following the rules. They broke the law. And because it's difficult to catch this kind of law-breaking, they end up making the penalties draconian. Don't forget what Mises said. It's important to remember, he says, that government interference always means either violent action or the threat of such action. Government is in the last resort the employment of armed men, of policemen, gendarmes, soldiers, prison guards, and hangmen. The essential feature of government is the enforcement of its decrees by beating, killing, and imprisoning. Physicians are getting hammered by governments who are intent on preserving their set of regulations without regard for the well-being of the patient. Now, I don't doubt that a lot of regulators think that what they're doing is for the good of the patient. I don't know how you'd live with yourself if you didn't think that. But they are wrong. You see this kind of thing in the news. This is from 2009. Physicians snared by growing Medicare fraud strike team. Strike team. Criminal charges are being filed. So the government is relying on Medicare data analysis to detect not only fraudulent billing, but also quality lapses as they see them. For example, the June 24th, this is 2009, legal actions focused on services that were suspected to be medically unnecessary or not provided at all. Pray tell, how is that distant evaluator of this physician supposed to tell what is medically necessary or unnecessary? Edgardo Perez de Leon in Michigan, a former office manager for his wife's internal medicine practice, was convicted of 12 felony counts of Medicaid false claims and healthcare false claims offenses because he coded patient visits that did not involve a physical examination as office visits. The coding was the closest match available consistent with the recommended manuals. Physical examination is not necessarily required on every occasion. So he spent a year in jail while his family house was threatened with foreclosure and their children were sent back to Puerto Rico to live with family because they couldn't afford to support them. He was never able to get a clarification of what the government meant by an office visit. A 2000 survey of doctors regarding Medicare fraud found that the system's structure made fraud easy and unintentional errors virtually unavoidable. The system now is that if you're a doctor and you make an error, it's regarded as fraud. 82% of doctors in this survey reported increased fear of prosecution or investigation in the last 3 years. 71% said that they were making changes in their practice to avoid the threat of prosecution. More than a third were restricting services to Medicare patients. 20% reported that they do not want to accept new Medicare patients because of hassles or threats from Medicare. Only 16% said it was because Medicare fees were too low, although that may increase with what's going on now. Almost a fourth do not accept new Medicare patients at all. 9% only do so under special circumstances. More than a third have difficulty finding finding physicians willing to accept referrals of their Medicare. More than a third of physicians are having difficulty finding physicians willing to accept the referrals of their Medicare patients. Again, hassles and threats of Medicare. A 2002 GAO study found that 85% of the time, Medicare customer service representatives were giving the wrong answer to questions posed by physicians regarding the proper way to bill Medicare. But if you don't bill it properly, you could be accused of fraud, dragged off to jail. The Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services said, well, we're going to do better. So, 2004, 96% of the time, Medicare customer service representatives gave the wrong answer. Medicare policies and regulations were so complex that their own customer service representatives, I hate it when governments call their clients or their subjects customers, like I have some kind of choice. I go to the DMV and I'm regarded as a customer. Anyway. Now, this bureaucracy that Mises mentions, the problems of bureaucracy, the bureaucracy does not work in favor of patients. Sometimes it's giving hospitals the incentives to churn patients through the hospital as fast as they can. You get in, you get out, because the hospital is reimbursed according to the diagnosis and not for any treatments that follow. Once you get the diagnosis, you're in, and they want to get you out as soon as they can. The physicians have the opposite incentive because the more tests, the more therapy, the more they get reimbursed. Now, you might think, well, this will cancel each other out nicely. Well, no, it doesn't. For some patients, they'll be in the hospital too long, and for other patients, they won't be there long enough. Depending on whether the hospital or the physician incentives are dominant. All right, I'm running short of time, so I'm going to move forward here. One of the key problems that has emerged in medical care as governments have intervened between the patient and the doctor is that you have a distance in a principal agent problem. The patient and the doctor are separated by another tier of institutions, these intermediaries. So care providers begin to work for the satisfaction of the regulators and the third-party payers, either the government or an insurance company, rather than working for the patient. You get all these competing standards. You get the patient's own standards, which ought to be dominant. You get competition between the employer and the insurance company. The insurance companies are bidding. They're not so much trying to get the contracts with the patients as they are trying to get contracts with the employers. The patient's trying to persuade the government to do something with medical care. You get the regulation from the government to the care provider. You get the lobbying from the insurance company to the government. You get the regulation from the government to the insurance company. You get the efficiency standards from the insurance company to the care provider. What's being left out here is the connection between the patient and the care provider. All these other institutions that are intervening between that critical connection between the patient and the care provider. 40 to 45%, I think actually is more like 50% now, 50% to slightly over 50%, 51% of money comes from the government to the care providers. This is somewhat dated. In the last few years, of course, we've seen some big changes in this. About 40% comes from insurance. And this is, I was giving this presentation a while back, and I should have changed this on the slide. It's not 15 to 20% coming from the patient to the care provider. It's less than that. So who is the care provider going to pay attention to? The patient, or the government regulator, or the insurance company evaluator? Less and less often is it the patient. Moral hazard. Those of you that have had economics courses at the principal's level understand moral hazard. It's the risk that an insured person is going to engage in activities that are undesirable because they make it more likely the claims will be larger. Now, if you think about how government-provided medical care is performing compared to the private sector, one of the accusations against private insurance is that they're denying claims. They're not, and you know, I get papers students submit to me arguing that private sector needs regulation because private sector insurance companies didn't pay for my surgery that I needed and so forth. Well, Medicare, according to a 2008 AMA survey, denies 6.85% of its claims, which is higher than any private insurer. We can also look, as Professor Hamowy did on Tuesday, at medical systems in other countries, and we can see, well, how do they perform compared to the relatively, that's an important word, relatively market-oriented system in the United States. By no means is what we have today in medical care a market-oriented system, but it is closer to that than you would see in some neighboring countries, comparable countries. In 2006, there were 2.1 practicing physicians per 1,000 people in Canada, 2.4 per 1,000 in the United States. Canada has 8.8 practicing nurses per 1,000, 10.5 in the U.S. And I put Professor Hamowy's link up here so that if you refer back to this, you can, the audio, as I said, is already there on Mises.org, and you can listen to that talk if you want to refresh your memory on this. This was just about 3 days ago. Medicaid's costs have risen far more than the cost of private health care. Even though the health care costs for the young, which Medicare does not cover, have risen faster than for the old over time. Medicaid covers all age groups, but Medicaid costs are rising at similar speeds. So the black line on this graph here, this is the cost containment record for these two flagship programs in the United States, Medicare and Medicaid. The black line there is the combined annual per patient cost of Medicare and Medicaid in current dollars from about 1970 to 2008. The red line there is the combined annual per patient cost of all other health care in the United States, current dollars. If you want to contain medical care costs, government's not the answer to that. It's been driving costs upward. Again, we can compare to other countries. In 2006, the United States had far more MRI machines per million people than the UK or Canada. And Professor Hamowy mentioned another kind of medical imaging technology that was virtually unavailable in Canada, PET, I think. Scanners were essentially not available. CT scanners, now I'm not arguing that technology is equivalent to better medical care, but it's an indicator. In the United States, we've got far more CT scanners than the UK or Canada. The UK has higher rates of death from heart attack, stroke, and cancer than the United States. These are areas where medical intervention might play some role in helping people be healthier and live longer. Canada has higher rates for heart attack and cancer. Cancer survival rates are better in the United States. And as Professor Hamowy mentioned so eloquently on Tuesday, the wait times to see doctors are far shorter in the United States than they are in countries like Canada. And here you see on this chart, on the left-hand side, you have the percentage of patients who have short waits, and on the right side of the graph, you have the percentage of patients who have long waits. In the United States, which is the red bar, 74% of patients have short waits compared to, say, Canada, where it's 40% have short waits. Long waits is 10% in the United States. In Canada, it's 42%. Do not go to Canada if you want quick medical care. Unless, I guess, you're a dog or a horse, in which case you... I had to put this in here because, you know, of course you think Austin Powers and all the bad teeth and everything, but of course, there's a reason for this, right? Why are the British pulling out their own teeth with pliers in the garage? Real story. This is 2007. It says some English people have resorted to pulling out their own teeth because they cannot find or cannot afford a dentist. 6% of those, 6% may not sound like a lot, but how many people in the United States do you know that do this? 6% of those questioned in a survey of 5,000 patients admitted they had resorted to self-treatment using pliers and glue. Well, they have a two-tier dental system. They have either the publicly subsidized treatment through the National Health Service and other people who perform private work, which is more expensive. Now, it may be publicly subsidized, but if you can't get the care because you can't find a dentist willing to accept you because of the shortages, and the lines and the weights, then it's effectively not available. 3/4 of those polled said they had been forced to pay for private treatment because they had been unable to find a National Health Services dentist. Almost 1/5 said they had refused dental treatment because of the cost. One respondent in Lancashire, Northern England, claimed to have extracted 14 of her own teeth with a pair of pliers. I think you only have 32, right? I took most of my teeth out in the shed with pliers. I have one to go. Another response. I don't know if that means one more that needs to be extracted or one more that's left in the mouth. I don't know. But other people said they had fixed broken crowns using glue to avoid costly dental work. Valerie Hallsworth says she told British Television's TV she had removed 7 of her own teeth using her husband's pliers when her toothache became unbearable and she was unable to find a government dentist willing to treat her. Even the National Health Services is admitting this system is failing. All right, to sum up now, because I'm out of time. Pharmaceutical regulation kills people. That's about as quick as I can say that in a nutshell. Bureaucracy produces rule-based behavior instead of entrepreneur-directed discretionary behavior. So we, again, have more death, more suffering. We have bureaucrats operating according to their rules, which are not necessarily conducive to the patient's well-being in individual cases. And we know also that principal agent problems emerge as third-party payers like the government separate the patient from the doctor. Finally, we've seen that moral hazard problems created by third-party payers increase medical costs, leading governments to ration care as they do in countries that have more statist medical systems than our own here in the United States. I'm sorry that I don't have time to take questions, but I'll be happy to talk to you afterwards if you like. I'll stick around for a few minutes until the next speaker comes in and be happy to talk with you as much as I can. Thank you.